Stories and Documentary Network. In the heart of the Indian subcontinent lies an ancient civilization whose legacy echoes through time. Welcome to Echoes of the Indus, unveiling an ancient civilization, a journey back to the cradle of one of the oldest and most enigmatic cultures in human history, the Indus Valley Civilization. Dating back to the 3rd millennium BCE, the Indus Valley Civilization was situated in what is now modern-day Pakistan and northwest India. Its fertile plains nurtured one of the world's first complex societies, where monumental cities emerged along the banks of the mighty Indus River. The tale of this remarkable civilization began with a chance discovery in the 1920s. As archaeologists unearthed the ancient sites of Harappa and Mohenjo-Daro, they uncovered a lost chapter of human history, offering a glimpse into a highly sophisticated society that thrived thousands of years ago. The sheer scale and complexity of the urban planning, intricate drainage systems, and advanced architecture found in these ruins have puzzled historians, inviting questions about the society's origins and evolution. For decades, scholars and scientists have toiled to unravel the mysteries surrounding this civilization. The significance of the Indus Valley Civilization extends beyond its antiquity. It offers a treasure trove of knowledge and cultural heritage that resonates even in the contemporary world. Join us in this exploration of the Indus Valley Civilization as we delve into its geography, urban marvels, social structure, economy, and its lasting legacy. From its rise to its mysterious decline, we embark on a journey to uncover the secrets of an ancient society that has left indelible imprints on history. The echoes of the Indus Valley Civilization whisper through time, urging us to decode its enigmatic past. Let us step into the river of antiquity, where the past speaks to our present. The dawn of the 20th century marked a pivotal moment in the study of human history as an extraordinary revelation emerged from the soil of the Indian subcontinent. The story of Harappa and Mohenjo-Daro began with an accidental find that would rewrite our understanding of ancient civilizations. In 1921, a British archaeologist named Sir John Marshall stumbled upon the remnants of an ancient civilization while overseeing railway construction in Punjab, modern-day Pakistan. What he discovered was Harappa, an enigmatic city buried beneath layers of time, revealing a civilization lost to the annals of history. Around the same time, another significant site emerged, the magnificent city of Mohenjo-Daro, where archaeologists unearthed a wealth of artifacts and architectural marvels. These groundbreaking discoveries propelled the Indus Valley Civilization into the spotlight of archaeological research. The accidental discoveries of Harappa and Mohenjo-Daro reshaped our understanding of the ancient past, shedding light on a civilization that rivaled the great cultures of Mesopotamia and Egypt. The revelation of these cities prompted an intensified scholarly pursuit to comprehend the civilization's rise, peak, and eventual decline, sparking debates and multiple theories regarding its origins and demise. The study of the Indus Valley Civilization has been rife with speculation and scholarly debate. Some scholars propose indigenous development, suggesting that the civilization evolved from local cultures. Others argue for external influences, positing connections with Mesopotamia and other ancient societies. The mysterious script found on numerous artifacts remains undeciphered, adding another layer of intrigue to this ancient society. The ongoing quest to unravel the language and symbols etched into seals and tablets continues to baffle linguists and archaeologists. The discovery of Harappa and Mohenjo-Daro ignited an ongoing journey to unravel the complex narrative of the Indus Valley Civilization. Join us as we navigate the intricate urban planning and geographical significance that shaped this enigmatic civilization. Subsequently, vestiges of the civilization were found as far apart as Sutkagandor in southwestern Balochistan province, Pakistan, near the shore of the Arabian Sea, about 300 miles, 480 kilometers, west of Karachi, and at Ropar, or Rupar, in eastern Punjab state, northwestern India, at the foot of the Shimla Hills some 1,000 miles, 1,600 kilometers, northeast of Sutkagandor. Later exploration established its existence southward down the west coast of India as far as the Gulf of Cambat, Cambay, 500 miles, 800 kilometers, southeast of Karachi, and as far east as the Yamuna, Jumna, river basin, 30 miles, 50 kilometers, north of Delhi. It is thus decidedly the most extensive of the world's three earliest civilizations, even though Mesopotamian and Egyptian civilizations both began somewhat before it. The Indus civilization is known to have consisted of two large cities, Harappa and Mohenjo-Daro, and more than 100 towns and villages, often of relatively small size. The two cities were each perhaps originally about 1 mile, 1.6 kilometers, square in overall dimensions, and their outstanding magnitude suggests political centralization, either in two large states or in a single great empire with alternative capitals, a practice having analogies in Indian history. It is also possible that Harappa succeeded Mohenjo-Daro, which is known to have been devastated more than once by exceptional floods. The population was estimated to be 23,500 to 35,000 in Harappa and 35,000 to 41,250 in Mohenjo-Daro. The southern region of the civilization, on the Kathiawar Peninsula and beyond, appears to be of later origin than the major Indus sites. The Indus civilization apparently evolved from the villages of neighbors or predecessors, using the Mesopotamian model of irrigated agriculture with sufficient skill to reap the advantages of the spacious and fertile Indus River Valley while controlling the formidable annual flood that simultaneously fertilizes and destroys. Having obtained a secure foothold on the plain and mastered its more immediate problems, the new civilization, doubtless with a well-nourished and increasing population, would find expansion along the flanks of the great waterways an inevitable sequel. The civilization subsisted primarily by farming, supplemented by an appreciable but often elusive commerce. Wheat and six-row barley were grown. Field peas, mustard, sesame, and a few date stones have also been found, as well as some of the earliest known traces of cotton. Domesticated animals included dogs and cats, humped and shorthorn cattle, domestic fowl, and possibly pigs, camels, and buffalo. The Asian elephant probably was also domesticated, and its ivory tusks were freely used. The Indus Valley civilization unfolded amidst a land teeming with natural wonders. The convergence of the mighty Indus River and its tributaries carved a fertile landscape that nurtured one of the world's most intriguing ancient societies. Spanning across what is now modern-day Pakistan and northwest India, the civilization flourished in an area roughly 500,000 square kilometers, boasting a diverse topography that ranged from fertile plains to the rocky foothills of the Himalayas. The urban centers of Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa stood as beacons of the civilization's architectural ingenuity and meticulous urban planning. The city layout showcased an exceptional understanding of town planning, indicative of a remarkably advanced society for its time. The cities were meticulously organized with well-planned streets, advanced drainage systems, and remarkably uniform brick houses, suggestive of a centralized authority overseeing construction. The urban planning of Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa was centuries ahead of its time, featuring a grid-like layout with well-aligned streets and an advanced sewage system that rivaled some contemporary cities. The understanding of hydraulics was evident in their intricate drainage system, with covered drains beneath the streets to manage wastewater and prevent flooding, reflecting a level of sophistication rarely seen in ancient civilizations. The architecture of the Indus Valley civilization boasted grand structures, public baths, and communal gathering places, suggesting a society that valued community and public welfare. The civilization's profound knowledge of water management, town planning, and architectural finesse was a testament to their pioneering spirit. Their legacy endures, offering lessons and insights into urban development that resonate even in modern times. Within the confines of the Indus Valley civilization existed a complex and organized social structure that delineated the roles and responsibilities of its inhabitants. The governance, social hierarchy, and cultural practices woven into their daily lives painted a vivid picture of an ancient society thriving with purpose. At the apex of the societal structure were rulers or administrators who oversaw city affairs and maintained order, suggesting a centralized authority guiding the civilization. Although the exact nature of governance remains enigmatic due to the undeciphered script, seals and artifacts hint at a hierarchical system, possibly involving a ruling elite or priestly class. The social fabric of the Indus Valley civilization was woven with a rich tapestry of daily life, cultural practices, and religious beliefs. The archaeological record reveals a society engaged in various professions, including craftsmen, traders, farmers, and laborers. The existence of standardized weights and measures suggests a structured trade system, highlighting the economy's well-regulated nature. The evidence of seals and amulets hints at a possible religious or spiritual aspect integrated into their daily lives, showcasing a belief system that was an integral part of their existence. The civilization's art, pottery, and religious symbols unearthed from excavations offer glimpses into their beliefs and cultural expressions. Elaborate rituals and communal gatherings were likely a central part of their societal structure. Through the annals of time, the Indus Valley civilization's social structure and daily practices leave an indelible mark on history, presenting a multifaceted and thriving society whose legacy continues to intrigue and inspire. Despite a growing body of archaeological evidence, the social and political structures of the Indus state remain objects of conjecture. The apparent craft specialization and localized craft groupings at Mohenjo-Daro, along with the great divergence in house types and size, point toward some degree of social stratification. Trade was extensive and apparently well-regulated, providing imported raw materials for use at internal production centers, distributing finished goods throughout the region, and arguably culminating in the establishment of Harappan colonies in both Mesopotamia and Badakhshan. The remarkable uniformity of weights and measures throughout the Indus lands, as well as the development of such presumably civic works as the Great Granaries, implies a strong degree of political and administrative control over a wide area. Further, the widespread occurrence of inscriptions in the Harappan script almost certainly indicates the use of a single lingua franca. Nevertheless, in the absence of inscriptions that can be read and interpreted, it is inevitable that far less is known of these aspects of the Indus civilization than those of contemporaneous Mesopotamia. Commerce and trade were the lifeblood of the Indus Valley civilization, fostering a robust economy that flourished through vibrant exchange networks. The civilization's economic prowess and technological advancements laid the foundation for a thriving and interconnected society. The extensive trade routes that connected the Indus Valley civilization to Mesopotamia, Central Asia, and other ancient regions were vital arteries of economic growth. The exchange of goods and cultural ideas through these trade connections significantly contributed to the civilization's prosperity. Excavations have revealed an array of skilled crafts, including pottery, metalwork, beadmaking, and textile production, reflecting a society with diverse and sophisticated industries. The standardization of weights, measures, and trade items further attests to a well-organized economic system. The intricate craftsmanship of artifacts such as seals and jewelry suggests a high level of skill and artistry, indicating the civilization's proficiency in crafts and their penchant for artistic expression. The discovery of agricultural tools and storage facilities indicates an advanced understanding of agriculture, enabling the civilization to sustain a thriving economy based on surplus produce. The significance of artifacts in understanding the civilization's trade networks and cultural exchange cannot be overstated. Seals with intricate inscriptions and unique symbols provide glimpses into the administration of trade and possibly the identification of goods and traders. The artifacts discovered in these ancient sites serve as invaluable pieces of the puzzle, offering insights into the far-reaching trade networks, cultural interchanges, and the economic sophistication of the Indus Valley civilization. Excavations of Indus cities have produced much evidence of artistic activity. Such finds are important because they provide insights into the minds, lives, and religious beliefs of their creators. Stone sculpture is extremely rare, and much of it is quite crude. The total repertoire cannot compare to the work done in Mesopotamia during the same periods. The figures are apparently all intended as images for worship. Such figures include seated men, recumbent composite animals, or, in unique instances, from Harappa, a standing nude male and a dancing figure. The finest pieces are of excellent quality. There is also a small but notable repertoire of cast bronze figures, including several fragments and complete examples of dancing girls, small chariots, carts, and animals. The technical excellence of the bronzes suggests a highly developed art, but the number of examples is still small. They appear to be Indian workmanship rather than imports. The popular art of the Harappans was in the form of terracotta figurines. The majority are of standing females, often heavily laden with jewelry, but standing males, some with beard and horns, are also present. It has been generally agreed that these figures are largely deities, perhaps a great mother and a great god, but some small figures of mothers with children or of domestic activities are probably toys. There are varieties of terracotta animals, carts, and toys, such as monkeys pierced to climb a string and cattle that nod their heads. Painted pottery is the only evidence that there was a tradition of painting. Much of the work is executed with boldness and delicacy of feeling, but the restrictions of the art do not leave much scope for creativity. Perhaps the best-known artifacts of the Indus civilization are a number of small seals. The seals were generally cut from steatite, soapstone, and were carved in intaglio or incised with a copper burin, cutting tool. The great majority of seals show a humpless, unicorn, or bull in profile, while others show the Indian humped bull, elephant, bison, rhinoceros, or tiger. The animal frequently stands before a ritual object, variously identified as a standard, a manger, or even an incense burner. A considerable number of the seals contain scenes of obvious mythological or religious significance. The interpretation of these seals is, however, often highly problematic. The seals were certainly more widely diffused than other artistic artifacts and show a much higher level of workmanship. Probably they functioned as amulets, as well as more practical devices to identify merchandise. Copper and bronze were the principal metals used for making tools and implements. These include flat oblong axes, chisels, knives, spears, arrowheads, of a kind that was evidently exported to neighboring hunting tribes, small saws, and razors. All these could be made by simple casting, chiseling, and hammering. Bronze is less common than copper, and it is notably rarer in the lower levels. Four main varieties of metal have been found. Crude copper lumps in the state in which they left the smelting furnace, refined copper, containing trace elements of arsenic and antimony, an alloy of copper with 2-5% of arsenic, and bronze with a tin alloy, often of as much as 11-13%. The copper and bronze vessels of the Harappans are among their finest products, formed by hammering sheets of metal. Casting of copper and bronze was understood, and figurines of men and animals were made by the lost wax process. These two are technically outstanding, though the overall level of copper-bronze technology is not considered to have reached the level attained in Mesopotamia. Other metals used were gold, silver, and lead. The latter was employed occasionally for making small vases and such objects as plumb bobs. Silver is relatively more common than gold, and more than a few vessels are known, generally in forms similar to copper and bronze examples. Gold is by no means common and was generally reserved for such small objects as beads, pendants, and brooches. Other special crafts include the manufacture of faience, earthenware decorated with colored glazes, for making beads, amulets, sealings, and small vessels, and the working of stone for bead manufacture and for seals. Beads were made from a variety of substances, but the carnelians are particularly noteworthy. They include several varieties of etched carnelian and long barrel beads made with extraordinary skill and accuracy. Shell and ivory were also worked and were used for beads, inlays, combs, bracelets, and the like. The pottery of the Indus cities has all the marks of mass production. A substantial proportion is thrown on the wheel, probably the same kind of footwheel that is still found in the Indus region and to the west to this day, as distinguished from the Indian spun wheel common throughout the remaining parts of the subcontinent. The majority of the pottery is competent plain ware, well-formed and fired but lacking in aesthetic appeal. A substantial portion of the pottery has a red slip and is painted with black decoration. Larger pots were probably built up on a turntable. Among the painted designs, conventionalized vegetable patterns are common, and the elaborate geometric designs of the painted pottery of Baluchistan give way to simpler motifs, such as intersecting circles or a scale pattern. Birds, animals, fish, and more interesting scenes are comparatively rare. Of the vessel forms, a shallow platter on a tall stand, known as the offering stand, is noteworthy, as is a tall cylindrical vessel perforated with small holes over its entire length and often open at top and bottom. The function of this latter vessel remains a mystery. Although little has survived, very great interest attaches to the fragments of cotton textiles recovered at Mohenjo-Daro. These provide the earliest evidence of a crop and industry for which India has long been famous. It is assumed that the raw cotton must have been brought in bales to the cities to be spun, woven, and perhaps dyed, as the presence of dyer's vats would seem to indicate. Stone, although largely absent from the great alluvial plain of the Indus, played a major role in Harappan material culture. Scattered sources, mostly on the periphery, were exploited as major factory sites. Thus, the stone blades found in great numbers at Mohenjo-Daro originated in the flint quarries at Sukkur, where they were probably struck in quantity from prepared cores. Evidence of the actual exportation of objects is not always easy to find, but the wide diffusion of chert blades made of the characteristic Sukkur stone and the enormous scale of the factory at the Sukkur site strongly suggest trade. Other items also appear to indicate trade, such as the almost identical bronze carts discovered at Chanhu-Daro and Harappa, for which a common origin must be postulated. The wide range of crafts and special materials employed must also have caused the establishment of economic relations with people living outside the Harappan state. Such trade may be considered to be of two kinds. First, the obtaining of raw materials and other goods from the village communities or forest tribes in regions adjoining the Indus culture area. And second, trade with the cities and empires of Mesopotamia. There is ample indication of the former type, even if the regions from which specific materials were derived are not easy to pinpoint. Gold was almost certainly imported from the group of settlements that sprang up in the vicinity of the goldfields of northern Karnataka, and copper could have come from several sources, principally from Rajasthan. Lead may have come from Rajasthan or elsewhere in India. Lapis lazuli was probably imported from Iran rather than directly from the mines at Badakhshan, and turquoise probably also came from Iran. Among others were fuchsite, a chromium-rich variety of muscovite, from Karnataka, alabaster from Iran, amethyst from Maharashtra, and jade from Central Asia. There is little evidence of what the Harappans gave in exchange for these materials, possibly non-durable goods such as cotton textiles and probably various types of beads. They may have also bartered tools or weapons of copper. For the trade with Mesopotamia, there is both literary and archaeological evidence. The Harappan seals were evidently used to seal bundles of merchandise, as clay seal impressions with cord or sack marks on the reverse side testify. The presence of a number of Indus seals at Ur and other Mesopotamian cities and the discovery of a Persian Gulf type of seal at Lothal, otherwise known from the Persian Gulf ports of Dilmun, present-day Bahrain, and Failica, as well as from Mesopotamia, provide convincing indication of sea trade with other civilizations. Timber and precious woods, ivory, lapis lazuli, gold, and luxury goods such as carnelian beads, pearls, and shell and bone inlays, including the distinctly Indian kidney shape, were among the goods sent to Mesopotamia in exchange for silver, tin, wool and textiles, and grains and other foods. Copper ingots appear to have been imported to Lothal from a place known as Magan, possibly in present-day Oman. Other probable trade items include products originating exclusively in each respective region, such as bitumen, occurring naturally in Mesopotamia, and cotton textiles and chickens, major products of the Indus region not native to Mesopotamia. Mesopotamian trade documents, lists of goods, and official inscriptions mentioning Mela, the ancient Akkadian name for the Indus region, supplement Harappan seals and archaeological finds. Literary references to Mela on trade date from the Akkadian, Ur III, and Isin-Larsa periods, i.e., circa 2350-1794 BCE, but, as texts and archaeological data indicate, the trade probably started in the early dynastic period, circa 2600 BCE. During the Akkadian period, Melaon vessels sailed directly to Mesopotamian ports. But by the Isin-Larsa period, Dilmun was the entrepot for Melaon and Mesopotamian traders. By the subsequent Old Babylonian period, trade between the two cultures evidently had ceased entirely. The prosperity that once adorned the grand cities of the Indus Valley civilization eventually gave way to an enigmatic decline. Unraveling the mystery behind this decline has long intrigued historians and archaeologists, sparking debates and diverse theories about the civilization's ultimate fate. Numerous theories abound, proposing factors such as natural disasters, environmental changes, invasion, or shifts in trade routes as potential causes for the downfall of these once thriving cities. Yet, the precise reason remains shrouded in mystery. Despite its decline, the legacy of the Indus Valley civilization echoes through time, leaving an indelible imprint on the annals of history. Its innovations, trade practices, and artistic expressions continued to inspire and influence succeeding civilizations and cultures. The civilization's contributions to urban planning, trade, and artistry have had a lasting impact, evident in the subsequent cultural developments in the Indian subcontinent and beyond. The legacy of the Indus Valley Civilization is seen in the continuity of certain practices and cultural elements that persist in modern South Asian societies, reflecting a cultural continuum that spans millennia. In contemporary studies, the civilization remains a focal point, driving scholarly efforts to decode its undeciphered script and to further understand its societal structure, governance systems, and the intricacies of ancient urban living. Modern technologies, such as remote sensing and DNA analysis, continue to illuminate the civilization's past, offering new avenues for understanding its complexity and the far-reaching influence it has on our understanding of ancient history. The enigmatic decline of the Indus Valley Civilization might remain an unsolved mystery, but its legacy endures, permeating through time and inspiring the exploration of ancient civilizations. Its influence on modern society remains a testament to the everlasting importance of this remarkable ancient culture. The end of Mohenjo-Daro is known, however, and was dramatic and sudden. Mohenjo-Daro was attacked toward the middle of the second millennium BCE by raiders who swept over the city and then passed on, leaving the dead lying where they fell. Who the attackers were is matter for conjecture. The episode would appear to be consistent in time and place with the earlier invaders from the north, believed to be Indo-European speakers, into the Indus region as reflected in the older books of the Rigveda, in which the newcomers are represented as attacking the walled cities, or citadels, of the aboriginal peoples and the invaders' war god Indra as rending forts, as age consumes a garment. However, one thing is clear. The city was already in an advanced stage of economic and social decline before it received the coup de grace. Deep floods had more than once submerged large tracts of it. Houses had become increasingly shoddy in construction and showed signs of overcrowding. The final blow seems to have been sudden, but the city was already dying. As we conclude our journey through the enigmatic corridors of the Indus Valley Civilization, we invite you, the explorers of history, to continue unveiling the mysteries of this fascinating ancient society. We call upon all enthusiasts of history, the custodians of knowledge, and those captivated by the ancient past. Join us in this ongoing expedition. Share the narrative, subscribe to our channels, and support the endeavors that seek to preserve and understand this precious legacy.